This content is brought to you by Huawei. Digitally printed solar cells are customizable, energy efficient, and come at much, much lower cost, making Perovskia a market disruptor. Its founder, Anand Verma, a printed electronics expert, started a company to develop renewable solar energy that will facilitate a greener future. Enjoy this video interview directly from MWC in Barcelona. Anand, thank you so much for taking the time today. I'm really excited to talk about you and your startup today. And, you know, as very important is to have the people and the team behind every startup. I'm super curious to get to know you better. And I think the best way to do that is like if you tell me quickly a little bit about yourself.
Oh, thank you. So my name is Anand Verma and I was born in a small capital city in India. Small for India means close to 2 million people. So that's not funny for Switzerland.
That's big for Switzerland, yeah.
Yeah, so that's really awesome in that sense. And then I studied in a Christian missionary school, I moved globally quite a lot. Also in India, I moved to southern part in near Bangalore to do my engineering. Mm-hmm. I studied print and media technology, then moved to Delhi, worked there. And then I didn't want it to become a manager. So I went to Germany to study more science or technology.
Yeah.
And there I did, my focus of study was on printed electronics. And then I worked in many startups. And from there, exposure to startup and high tech, nanotechnology, clean tech and deep tech technologies came.
Right. So what is your academic background? In the side of what we're going to discuss afterwards after your startup?
Yeah, so academic background is I did my master's, first engineering in India, and then my master's in Germany from TU Chemnitz. And then, as I said, I worked with Novaled, which is now part of Samsung. I worked in Hall Center in Netherlands, came back to Germany, worked in Sinora as a printing expert. And after that, I moved to Germany. Sorry, I moved to EMPA in Switzerland to work as a research scientist to upscale perovskite solar cells. And the success of the project lead to the startup.
So tell me, I mean, you know, there's so many routes you can take, especially you said like you worked in startups, you work in corporate, you work in all different like places, academia, if I understood correctly. So
yes.
What made you decide to take this tough journey of like starting your own company?
So it always takes a story, right? It's not one moment. Sometimes it is one moment which changes everything. But for me, it was a story and a feeling of a global citizen. Because I won a prize by UBS, I think, and it was for in Swiss Energy and Climate Summit way back, I think, in 2018. And there I had an opportunity to meet Mr. Ban Ki-moon, the former head of United Nations.
Yes.
And I had just a couple of minutes of talk, elevator talk, you can say, with him. And he said, what you do in my own Hindi, like in my mother tongue. And I was surprised, like, why a Korean would know Hindi, like a language from India? And then we had a small talk and he said, you're a scientist working on solar cells. But promise me that when your technology is ready, you will take it to market or to make a use of it for everyone.
Right.
Because it can solve energy crisis or a small piece of solution towards the energy challenge. And he behaved like a global citizen because he was UN has no power by itself, but he has the power just to call all state of heads. And that motivated me personally that as a human, we need to think about the future. And if I can contribute 0.00001% to do something good, I will do that.
Right.
So that's the main focus of me, like or the motivating factor. So I don't get stressed because I'm just working for something good to make something maybe very minuscule, but something good for the future.
That's very inspiring. Well, thank you for this answer.
Someone inspired me to my core, and I always think globally rather than just thinking, Swiss-based, Europe-based, Asia-based, or America-based. No, not America first, not Switzerland first, or not India first. Earth first is the time now.
Right.
You know, else we're going to lose the only planet where we can survive.
Right. Interesting. I mean, like, you know, most people, like they say, like they want to fulfill like something personal or they want to do like something like on their own level. But like, it's nice to, or refreshing to hear, you know, like that beyond the financial upside that there is, obviously,
yes,
that that you really have like the bigger picture in mind. Anyhow, so let's not keep all the audience waiting out there to hear like what you guys do. And sure. So maybe give me a quick introduction of your company.
Yeah, so our company is named Perovskia, and technically we have developed inkjet printing technology to fabricate perovskite solar cells. And that's what we want to put into every electronic devices. So mm-hmm. we can print any shape, any design you want. And this is because of our innovative digital printing technology and inks that we have developed in last 5 years. And of course, we patented that technology for a commercial application, you can say, or utilization.
Well, you need to teach me a little bit more, because again, like solar panel is maybe the most I know is that Elon Musk has a company about solar, so there's not much more that I know about it. But maybe you can teach me a little bit about, like, you know, what is the main problem? Like, where does it even start? Like, why do people need this? I just need to understand a little bit more. It's very technical. So I really want to break it down to a scenario where I even understand.
So just to imagine, like here sitting in this room, we can count many, many, many electronic devices, and all of them either has a battery or some sensors or some other way of charging in that sense. Mostly at the moment, we are surrounded by batteries. And all the electronic devices need to be charged. Mm-hmm. Wherever we go home, we put our smartwatch on charging, our phone on charging, and then we can sleep. So that's in our habit. And for many such applications, that's going to increase, because we will be living in much more advanced, smarter homes. So the number of sensors in the houses, in the industry, will just skyrocket. Already, there are more than 45 or 48 billion devices, electronic devices, and each human being already owns on an average 7 electronic devices.
Wow.
So that's a lot of devices.
Those are owned devices or used devices?
It's kind of owned device. On an average, if you see, there are 48 billion, if you divide by like kind of the number of people who owns it, and it's increasing. And by 2026, just the IoT market will be close to $1.6 trillion. So it's a huge market, but it comes with a pain, and the pain is of changing batteries and charging it, especially for IoT and IoT applications. What we envision is we can enhance the power, or the, you can say, battery lifetime by several years by putting a solar cells. And our solar cells work quite good in the indoor conditions, like here inside the
room.
Indoor, yes. So the good thing is, like, so solar cell exists, as you said. What's the problem with them? There are three problems, key problems. First is that they come in a fixed, rigid shape and size. And it's just because how they're produced. They're produced wafer by wafer. So you can buy a wafer, and if you want a shape, you have to cut from it. Mm-hmm. And that creates humongous waste and cost implications. The second is because they use silicon mostly, and the dominant technology, which works very good outside in sun, but when it brings inside, the performance drop just because how they absorb light.
Right.
And the third problem is really customize it. It will cost a lot, as I said. But what we bring in as Perovskia, as a startup, or with our technology, is we can print any shape and size thanks to our inks and printing technology. The perovskite material that we use, it's a very, very, very nice light absorbing material. Just in a, we can say, non-scientific sense, it's one of the best light absorbing material that humans know. Mm-hmm. And it absorbs quite a lot of visible light, like the light inside the room. And that makes it outstanding performer indoors. And the third thing is, of course, we use printing. And come on, you do printing at your home, so imagine doing that with solar cells. That reduces the production cost and the capex just to start a business to really a low digit number.
So I have my phone or my iPad, and you print me like some kind of solar cells that go onto my watch. And then if I walk around with it, like, it will absorb the light of the sun.
Yes.
And then recharge it as long as there is
sun. That's the beauty of it, because solar keeps working always, drop by drop. It's like electron by electron or holes by holes in technical sense. It will keep it charging. And if you walk outside for 2 hours, it will charge faster because it's getting the sun. And if you are inside, it will already keep charging. So it's more for like for tablets and phones. It's a very energy hungry device, so it can enhance its performance. But for smartwatches, it can be a game changer. Smartwatches can last longer, and traditional watches can also become autonomous in many senses.
Have you looked at the recent Tissot T-Touch solar panels?
Yes, so we are in Switzerland, and we would like to talk to them in that sense, because they also use, I think, some silicon to power the devices. And of course, we can offer a better solution in that sense. And yeah, with Swiss quality.
Right, right. No, because it's interesting, I guess, like they're like pioneering kind of like already the mass market. So like, I guess you're right on time.
Yes, Tissot T-Watch, what they did is like they also developed their own OS platform system. This means that it's not Android, if I believe, and not from Apple. So they build their own so that your data privacy and all these things are taken care of. It's not going to that's the belief to a giant company in that sense.
I mean, I've always wanted to buy, I was close to buying the watch, but it was like very like basic features that they had on the watch, and that's why I didn't end up buying
there are many smartwatch manufacturers and with solar capability that is already available, and we are contacting a few of them and sending our samples and getting tested.
Cool.
So we are moving forward in that direction.
Very good. So I think now I understood fully. So tell me, like, where do you stand in the development of the company? You know, what have you achieved in the last couple of years?
So
what's your plan?
So at the moment, what is strong with us, as I said, like we delayed the start of our startup just to mature the technology. And when we were working at EMPA, I was working at EMPA as a researcher. I developed it quite, you can say, to advanced level. And now we are incubated at Solaronics. It's one of our partner companies. And thanks to that, we have access to the production facility. So we have a demo line, and we can already produce at least 50,000 to 100,000 solar cells and supply them to our current existing leads and customer. So that's from the product and development side. We are very mature in that sense.
Right.
The technology is developed, and our cells has been, or devices or solar cells has been tested globally in Europe, in Asia, in America. And our customers really got sometimes 2 times more power, sometimes 4 times more power in their special devices. In terms of funding, thanks to our co-founder, we have a stable base, you can say, especially to produce something like access to raw materials, what you need, and access to a bit of manpower. And in terms of financial funding, we won 2 rounds of venture kick. So that's we have from the financial side. And in the team, we are 3 people at the moment. Me taking role as a CEO, then Dr. Tobias Meyer, he's taking role as a CTO, and Sandeep Raju, he's a board member, and he takes care of the investment and business development.
Mm-hmm. Very good. So tell me, what I like to do is, you know, like to think in decades or even longer.
Yes.
Tell me, where can your company go in a decade from now? How do you envision your company in 10 years from now?
So we want to develop step by step, but there should be a grand vision if your technology allows it. And we feel that we are sitting on a gold pile, technically, and that can be digged slowly, chiseled out. So that's what we want to do, develop slowly, just to have a very strong fundamentals and base, technical and production base, because that on that we can build up. And our dream would be to really commoditize solar cell. Like you go in Switzerland, if you're in Switzerland, go to Migros or Coop and just ask for, can I get double A solar cell, please? 5 of them. Or triple A solar cell, or this solar cell, or round solar cells, or rectangular solar cells, because we can collaborate or develop with electronic good manufacturers special slots where you can just pick and plug solar cells, and it will keep charging your devices forever. So that's a grand vision in 10 or 12 years, that we can commoditize solar cell, that you can buy it like a battery. But to reach there are many steps, and many, like we would like to start with ultra premium market segment, like as you said, at Tissot T-Watch, where we would like to have our solar cell, or work with Rolex or other Swiss company, IWC Schaffhausen, or these premium brands to provide specialized solar cells, the design that they want.
Right.
So we are in touch with one of the leading European watch manufacturer, and samples are exchanged and it's moving forward. Mm-hmm. And the next step would be to move to IoT and IoT market, which is a huge and growing market. And then at the last stage would be really to move and try to commoditize solar cells.
Tell me about the market itself. I mean, like, solar panels in general is a huge market, but maybe you can give me a little bit more context of like what it actually looks like. Maybe you have some numbers you can share.
So the thing is solar is now becoming one of the cheapest way of producing electricity. But as Perovskia, we are not focusing at the moment on the energy sector. The reason is obvious. Silicon is very competing in that sector. And most of the production has moved out of Europe. Mm-hmm. So if you want to have something in Europe, you need to have something specialized or super, in simple sense, technical, or still needs quite a bit of acumen to integrate those technology into specialized product. So our focus is on a small segment of energy. But when you see about solar farms, it's huge. Mm-hmm. It's everywhere, technically. Everywhere now, you can wherever go, which country you'll find it. But for us, we want to put solar into everyday life. And that's like generating, a miniaturized solar generating centers. A house can be, in itself, can generate several power. Like yesterday you saw at the Mobile World Convention, we just put a solar on top of a bulb and a fan was running for a whole day. So there is enough power in the room by the, in terms of light. And from there, we can capture light and make electricity. Mm-hmm. So that's our vision. So we don't focus yet on the energy market.
Mm-hmm. You briefly said about you got money from Venture Kick in two rounds. What are you fundraising? What's the past and what's ahead of you?
So at the moment, we have just pre-seed money from the Venture Kick. And the third round going to happen now. So we will most likely get 100-200K. Swiss francs in the funding, so that will solve the pre-seed round needs in that sense. And then we are looking to, we did unit economics calculations and that, to set up one unit which can produce 500,000 to 1,000,000 cell, solar cells of different size, and that's why it varies, 500,000 or 1,000,000, depending on the size, mm-hmm. what customer asks. And to reach that capability of production capability, we will need at least 1 to 1.5 million in seed round. That's what we are looking for. And we are in touch with few investors.
And from the timeline, when is this?
We want to close it by end of the year. That would be nice that we can accelerate the production process.
Mm-hmm. We primarily do this so investors get to know you better and get to start up better.
Sure.
We haven't really spoken yet about your business model, the revenue model. Mm-hmm. Maybe you can tell a little bit us where you stand there. Are you pre-revenue? Are you already have initial revenue? And what you're charging for?
So the thing is as we said, we start with a premium and ultra premium segment. And this premium is integration sensitive. This means we cannot just sell solar cell to a watch manufacturer, imagine. We need to also work with them to integrate the solar cells into a watch, be mm-hmm. it a smartwatch. If it's a smartwatch, it's a bit more complicated because there is a display and you have to integrate on top of a display. But I have experience working also in display industry, so that helps a bit.
Yes,
technically, because Novaled and Sinora supplied materials to Samsung, Novaled supplied material to Samsung. Mm-hmm. So it's in every Samsung watch, every Samsung mobile phone, that material is there. So that experience helps. So we help not only just provide them solar cells or make solar cells. So we help them in three stages. You design your solar cell. That's what we tell our customers. We will print them and we will integrate with you in your own devices. Mm-hmm. So these are the three steps that how we work. So now we are working with few market leading OEMs. So it's multi-billion dollar companies. And with them, we are in the final stage of integration. This means we generate money by non-recurring engineering or technology development. Okay. That we work with them for 6-7 months, and that we get paid for because we make some development samples, we make some special work for them which no one else knows how to do. So that makes our business very unique. So it's a B2B market that mm-hmm. we work directly with the businesses and help them integrate solar cells into their electronic devices. So this leg of company will keep working because it's already a huge market to cater to, And in future, we will move. Like at the moment, we are, you can say we are a project-based company.
Yeah.
And we would like to transition in 2 to 3 years to a product-based company where we can make hundreds and millions of products and off-shelf products, and people can, like companies can buy it. So moving to, from really high integration sensitive to a bit non-integration sensitive market. Mm-hmm. Of course, some kind of integration would be needed, but not to a complex level that you want to glue a solar cell to a display. Yes. In that sense.
But as far as I understand, like you want to stay a pure hardware company. Like there's no aspect of software or data.
Nothing.
As far as I understand.
Nothing. It's pure material science based company.
Cool.
Pure engineering, pure production company. Mm-hmm. That's been the vision.
And the production is continuing to be planned here in Switzerland, or you?
Yes.
Are you planning
so the thing is, like, it's a very low capex industry, and we need the access in at least for our integration sensitive market. We need access to world class Swiss university, like, or research centers like EMPA, ETH, or EPFL. The obvious reason, because they are complex projects. If to imagine, even to glue a display and a solar cell together is a bit complex than it seems, not just gluing technically.
Right.
So for that we need world-class engineers and scientists, and the central location in Europe of a, like of Switzerland, that really helps in that sense.
I mean, you definitely have top scientists here and good academic institutions to get you there. And the EMP also has a very good reputation for these kind of
Of course, it's
projects.
It's a leader in its own fields.
Very open-minded. I mean, like, I remember I had a tour there, and like they're very, very kind of like easygoing in terms of like what you can bring and try and test. And
It's a world-class research center. I was lucky to work with Professor Funkner's group and world-class people, one of the best you will find ever on the planet to work. So it's a really, I can encourage young scientists, go to EMPA, learn there, work there, grow, because they really help you grow and understand the science, explore the science. So yeah, that's the Swiss way of doing it.
Right. But we discussed this house. What's it called again? The special house at EMPA.
Ah, that's Nest.
This Nest, that is also very unique.
Yeah, they also, it's a research like how the future buildings might look.
Yes.
So it's amazing if you want to visit this beautiful building. It's keep changing because there are research going on. So it's like a building on move.
Right.
In that sense.
It's a fire industry. It's like just like the base. And then you can kind of like put in whatever you want. And like, you know, you can try new beds. You can try new walls. You can try new sockets. Everything can be tried and tested.
New materials, new heating system maybe. And that was not my research area. So I just know from the tours. And we used to play ping pong there. So, so that's the thing.
Very good. So I think now I fully understood. And let's move into the next topic. I think, like, you know, one of the key topics that I want to also focus more in my interviews is, you know, about like mental health and productivity. I think it's something that specifically, you know, founders can learn from each other, because I think we always, I mean, at least I can talk about myself. I always struggle a little bit about, like, you know, finding this balance or integration between work and life. And so I think it's a good topic to discuss a little bit more openly, give it a little bit of a voice also in front of investors, you know, so you can build a little bit of this personal connection. Tell me a little bit, where do you feel like, you know, what are your biggest, you know, challenges in mental health, you know, when you put them, you know, the business on the side and you say, like, okay, like, you know, are you stressed or you feel like you're, you know, it's, what are the toughest part of the job as an entrepreneur?
Actually, for me, it's very hard to put me under stress. The obvious reason is I just enjoy my work.
Yes.
So I'd never felt like I'm working. Mm-hmm. So it just feels like I'm not working because I just enjoy my work. So it's a part of my day-to-day life. But it's, as you said, it's, mental health is a key problem in our modern society, and that needs to be tackled. And the first step is to accept it, that something is wrong. There are burnouts in the companies. There are people who go through mental challenges just because of overwork or overstress or whatever. Mm. So it's very important to answer it. For me personally, I believe is, work exists because you exist. And coronavirus, COVID-19 taught us that health should be the priority. Mm-hmm. Because if you're not well or you die, then you cannot do much about it, technically. A human being is as useful as it's alive, technically. Right. We are not worth much other than our bones and some organs. We are not much worth, technically. So a human is as much worth as its brain. This means being alive is a very important part of it. And so please take care of your health. It's very important. And to strike a nice balance between your work and your personal life is also very important, because at the moment, yeah, we make our work our life, and that should not be the thing. The work should be a part of your life, because there are friends, there are your families, you have your hobbies, and all should have its own place. Mm-hmm. And the work should be the, what you can say, the paying factor of all the other things of your life. And if we keep that in mind, I think that already helps in organizing and planning your day. Don't overplan, don't overstress. The reason is obvious. If you're overstressed, you're non-productive. If you're a happy employee, even with 6 hours, you will do more than 8 hours.
Right.
So that's what I believe. So I don't let people just stress. Just provide a very jovial and a funny environment and let them work the way they want to work.
Right, right. I mean, like, you know, like you said, like, you're, it's very hard to stress you out. So I was saying, like, you know, like this stress level can be very different for different people. You know,
yes.
Sometimes, like, you know, people get stressed very easily. And but like, tell me, like, do you do anything actively to, let's say, you know, foster, you know, your personal life or your life in general?
Yes. So when I am home, when I have a small one, a 3-year-old boy, 3.5-year-old boy, when I come home, I shut everything down, because you will lose his first 5 years and you will never know that it passed if you're just involved in your work. Mm-hmm. And being a father is one of the great thing, or raising a human is also experience or experiment for me.
Experiment.
Yeah, it is a live experiment. You learn and you grow, because a kid behaves. One day he goes and come home, he went to a German kindergarten and he starts speaking French in the house, and you wonder why. Right. And then one day he will come and whole day he will speak Mamma Mia. And it's like, that's the beauty of humans. They learn, they grow.
Yes.
And when I see a baby, my own baby grow, that's one of the heartwarming part of being a father, technically,
right,
or being a human, to experience something new, mm-hmm, something, some extra. So when I come home, I shut myself down, and till the time he goes to his bed, I'm with him.
Right.
Feeding him, playing with him. And that is a stress buster.
Right.
Because there is no work when he is with you, technically. Or doing a sport, or go to your gym, or just listen to your music, watch a movie. And we are in Switzerland. Come on.
It's a
find your next mountain and climb it. Come on, just do a nice hike.
Yes.
It's so refreshing, you know.
Right.
I live in Biel now. We go swimming. Once in a while, there is a small hill, we climb, and then you go with your friends or your family or alone with your music, and it's just stress relieving. And you should invest time in yourself.
Mm-hmm.
That's a very important part of mental health and a productive employee, because if you are stressed, you will not be thinking. And we are in a technical job. We are not doing jobs where you can say your brain is not needed so much. You're really involved. Like most of the jobs, you have to be involved. And for that, a mental health, like a peaceful human being, is far more productive than a chaotic human being.
Right, right.
As we can feel.
Absolutely. I mean, like, I can only see, like, you know, we have 3 kids. So I'm saying, like, you know, if you're not there in the moment, especially, I'm talking about, like, let's say the first few days after the birth,
yes,
you know, you get, like, very quickly, like, okay, like, can I take off 5-6 days? And you feel bad after 10 days. But, like, the reality is, like, these first few hours, these first few days are so precious, and they're by like this.
I mean, yes, that's what
if you tell this to someone, like, who doesn't know or hasn't experienced, it's like, it's very hard to understand. Yeah. And, like, I think, like, this culture of, you know, like, you have to work more hours to do better or be more successful in the long term doesn't really make a difference, you know, like, so it's very refreshing to
one
hear
of
that
the golden, someone is, one of the golden rule for me would be, if I even make a big organization, if you're working more than 8 hours, you're not doing more for the company, but unfortunately maybe you're less productive.
Right.
So maybe you need training to develop your skills. You know, people forget that why people are, see, people are always good. The structures that you put in are bad.
Right.
The way you work is bad. And that can be improved, because it's a human creation. Is that what we have done, technically? So if an employee is performing not so good in certain sense, talk to him. It's a personal problem. Because at the end of the day, we are humans and we invest a lot of our time together at work. So we need to also behave like humans. We are not just transactional slips every month. It's right. your salary, not really. So we need to talk about that to your employees, invest some time with them, because that goes a long way. And then the second aspect is, if your work is organized and planned properly, 8 hours is more than you think. It's 1/3 of a day.
Right.
You know, sorry, 1/4 of a day, a working day in that sense. So it's a lot of time to work.
Absolutely. And just to circle back to one little thing that you said you're shutting everything off. Can you just like tell me what it is? Because again, like, you know, some people might say like, oh yeah, he's probably like checking his phone like once in a while or anything like this. Like shutting off, do you mean like really turn off everything?
So the thing is like, we don't have a television in our house.
Yes.
Because of garbage, if you ask me personally, in this 21st century. And phone is one of the biggest restrictions even for me. So now we are trying to have a rule in the house that when we come, we put our phone at the shoe rack.
Yes.
This means a phone should belong with the shoes when the kid is awake.
Yeah.
Technically, she should stay there. And then you play with your kids, have a nice dinner with the family. Try to talk, because now our wives also work and they also have challenging jobs. And when you talk to each other, it's already kind of a stress buster, because human can share stress, and they can share happiness, and they can share these emotions. That's why we are humans, technically. And you can talk to your wife, you can talk together about some things, and or your friends if they've invited them for dinner, and then it's already a stress reliever. And the phone and electronic gadgets should only be used personally. We try, but we don't get so much successful.
Right.
But we try our best to only use our phone once the guy is in the bed.
Yes.
And he's sound asleep. Then play your, I play games, so of course, it's another part of addiction. But then when he sleeps, then I can spend some time.
So what's your favorite book and why?
Sapiens from Yuval Noah Harari. Yeah, obviously, it's the story of us. It's a, like, in a, written in a nicely scientific, logical manner.
And right. Yeah, it's an amazing book. Can only recommend. I read all of them.
All three.
Sapiens,
Homo Deus, and the
21st.
Yes.
21 lessons for the 21st
century. I always recommend my friends to read it. The reason is obvious. It just opens your mind.
It does.
How we do.
Because it's so interesting, because, you know, like, I'm Jewish. So, you know, like, he's also Jewish. I'm not sure if you know. He's from Israel. And like, it's very interesting to hear, you know, like, the scientific approach to a lot of like the values that we see in, let's say, the world and the Bible and stuff like this, and to hear it from a different perspective. Fascinating. Can only agree on this. What is your plan for your company? Exit or IPO, and why?
I think IPO, because we got an interesting maybe a future investor who said, why not IPO? And it was like heartwarming to hear from an investor that, why not IPO? Then we said,
yes,
this one, please.
What is a successful entrepreneur for you?
I think a successful entrepreneur for me is not the one who exists or go to IPO, but really had fun with his technology and made a difference in the sector he worked in, technically. Mm-hmm. And also know how, when to evolve to the next stage. So because the technology keeps evolving, you have, your company needs to evolve with it. And if you can make that transitions on a long term, then it's an entrepreneur. I think the startup guys are more technical than an entrepreneur. So they transition to a CEO role. Like me, as a scientist, I developed the technology. Now I'm in a transition phase to become a full-fledged CEO, and that's learning the skills of the new job that I have technically. And if I can evolve further with the company, and I can take the company further in the next 2-3 levels, then I can call a successful entrepreneur.
If you think of one reason your startup could fail, what would it be?
It's a new technology, and there is always a fear of the market, of the people towards new technology. So technology acceptance is the main key, maybe the killer.
Right. And now if you look at your personal life, what is success in life for you?
Actually, I see my life as a journey, and I don't compare or compete. I'll compete in the sense, personally, it's just competition is with you.
Right.
So I don't see it as a successful transaction or non-successful transaction. I see it as a journey. And whatever I do today is with the best of my knowledge. But I make sure that in the coming days, I'm a bit more different person, a bit better evolved person. So it's not a success, it's a journey. And if you go to hike to Matterhorn, and you have topped on the top. When you call yourself that you're successful, when you reach the top, or the whole journey was beautiful.
Right.
So the whole journey was the beautiful. So there's sure. not a point. Success is like a point. Oh, became successful, non-successful. Life is not that. Life is a journey. It's a one thing that we have that we can enjoy to the fullest. And
sure.
that's what I believe. So I don't judge it.
Right. It's the analogy of like we can both build very big buildings. You know, like I don't have to tear you down or you down. Like we can both build like buildings and it's good.
100%.
Best advice you have received or you want to give over to the next generation, to your son maybe, you know, if he watches this on YouTube and so like my dad gave
me
this.
No advice is the best advice sometimes. But yeah, you have to share your experiences. That's how human society develops.
Yes.
Technically. And the best advice I got, I will not say maybe in 5 years I can give some advice when I'm more mature as an entrepreneur. But at the moment I can share the best advice I got. And that was from Mr. Ban Ki-moon, that take your technology for a greater good. If you can, if you're successful, take the next step. So I will also say to anyone, take the next step. It's just the next step, you know, one at a time.
Anand, thank you so, so much. It was really, really inspiring, really refreshing. I sincerely enjoyed our conversation. Thank you very much. I wish you much success on your journey, the way you define it. And yes, I'm happy to watch from the sideline and to talk to you again soon.
Yeah, and then see you back in Zurich.
Thank you.